learners, I'm Anisha Batra. Today, we are going to discuss the issues on the access and retention of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe children. After going through this unit, you would be able to understand the heterogeneity among the school-going children. You can visualize the educational problems of the deprived sections of the society. You would be able to work out methods to enhance access and retention of those children. You can adopt strategies to achieve equity in educational opportunities. Equity. Equity is an important issue in school education. There is a tremendous variation in the home background of the students attending Indian schools. On one hand, we have students who have internet connection at their homes. On the other extreme end, we have students who do not even get a daily newspaper for reading. On one hand, we have students with educated parents who can help them in their educational endeavor. And on the other end, we have students whose parents are utterly illiterate and hardly know the benefits of school education. Traditionally, certain communities have drawn benefit from education system, while certain other communities have remained aloof from it. It is a challenge to bridge this wide gap. There are more than 400 major castes among scheduled castes and over 500 different tribes among scheduled tribes in India. This unit attempts to discuss issues of the education of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes to encourage them to get benefit from school education. Now, let's discuss the issues on the access and retention of scheduled castes and scheduled tribe children. As per the Indian Constitution, the Government of India is committed to provide free and compulsory education to all children in the age group of 6 to 14 years. A variety of efforts have been made in the post-independence India to achieve this goal. A large number of primary schools were opened up throughout the country to ensure that a child has a school in the close proximity. At many places, a single teacher school was started to provide educational facilities in the village itself. Schemes like midday meal, distribution of school uniforms, assistance to girls from tribal areas were also implemented by the Government of India. All these efforts were made to ensure access and to enhance retention of children. These efforts were continued on a large scale under the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, SSA. Official data reveals that the educational progress of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe populations is quite remarkable, but only if one remains focused on the quantitative data and particularly on the enrollment. Sadly, the qualitative data reflects quite another picture. Initial access has little meaning unless it results in regular attendance, progression, meaningful learning, and appropriate access to post-primary education. Nevertheless, 100% enrollment and retention has still remained a dream. Now, let's discuss about the barriers of the education of scheduled caste children. For a long time, the caste system was prevailing in India, and a specific group of people was categorized as untouchables. These groups remained aloof from the education system. After independence, untouchability has been abolished by the law. The Constitution of India incorporates several special provisions for the promotion of the education and economic interest of these children. They are given protection from social injustice and all forms of exploitation. They are given free school education. They are offered a reservation even at the higher learning level. Then also, they have been discriminated on the various grounds, like segregated sitting. Segregated sitting arrangement is practiced in schools. The scheduled caste children are not allowed to sit with upper caste. They have been treated very badly. On certain occasions, they have been scolded for coming late to the school, and even not much attention was paid to them. Undue harsh behavior by upper caste children is quite common in the classrooms. They are being excluded to participate in the school functions and celebrations. Even the upper caste didn't allow them to participate in the morning assemblies. Not only this, at some places, these scheduled caste children are also asked to do menial tasks in schools, including sweeping the school premises or even cleaning the toilets. Peer groups often do not include scheduled caste children in games and play activities in the classroom. Poor treatment in schools and loss of self-worth and dignity results in dropouts or poor performance in examinations, thus undermining the opportunities to progress at the higher level of education. Many forms of discrimination have become a part of the accepted behavior. It goes unnoticed and unchallenged by the majority. Now, look at the intervention for these children. It has to be based on the intensive micro-planning that addresses the needs of every child. Some of the suggestions for the inclusion of these children in school can be: the first is establishing norms of behavior. Establishing norms within the school for teachers, for school staff, and the students. The teacher is a key figure. It plays an important role to ensure the successful implementation of inclusion in every classroom. Teachers have a special responsibility to educate first-generation learners of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. As a rule, the school staff should seek, provide, and ensure non-discrimination between the children of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes and other communities. Use of caste names, use of derogatory words while taking attendance of students should be avoided by the teachers. Teachers should lead all the children equally to participate in the curricular and co-curricular activities of the school. All the learners should be motivated to come at front. Frequent meetings between the staff and parents of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe should be arranged. Teacher training programs should be reoriented to deal with these children. Timely detection of the forms of discrimination must be practiced in a particular context, either by teachers or by school staff or by students. Norms for classroom interactions, such as sitting patterns that ensure children are not segregated on the basis of caste, community, or gender. Finding ways of listening to children's voice is very crucial, and the teacher is having that most responsibility to listen to every hurt of the child. There is a need to undertake systematic research into the learning hurdles faced by these students. The education of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe girls is a serious issue, as they are often disadvantaged. Gender equity is a major concern. As the dropout rate is higher among scheduled caste and scheduled tribe girls at the elementary level, though the government has provided special attendance scholarship for girls' child in order to keep them in school. Thus, we have seen the various problems and measures for the equal opportunity of education for these children. Now, let's discuss about the education of scheduled tribe children. There are numerous tribal communities in India with a population numbering more than 80 million and who live mostly in forested, hilly and mountainous areas. India's concerns toward the welfare of tribal people have been well reflected in our constitution. Article 46 of the constitution, which states that the state will promote their educational and economic development. As per the Indian Constitution, people belonging to scheduled tribes are given special incentives in schools as well as in higher education. But generally we found that a majority of the population belonging to scheduled tribe community is educationally backward. Efforts are being made since independence to bring them into the mainstream of education. DPEP, that is District Primary Education Program, it undertook special measures to attract students from tribal communities to enroll in nearby schools. Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, also continued with the same policy. Nevertheless, the success achieved is far from satisfactory. This issue therefore demands special attention. The tribal people living in different parts of the country have different lifestyles and associated problems. Generally, the problems of tribal people arise because of their isolation from the mainstream. They usually live in hilly terrains that are remote and inaccessible. Their economic status is very low, which forced them to send their children to work and supplement the family income. Many of the tribal students do not have adequate competence in using regional languages. They use their local dialect in day-to-day conversations. Their habitation areas are not conducive to schooling. The nomadic nature of these communities forces them to move from one place to another. Therefore, children face serious problems with regard to their education, as they cannot attend a particular school throughout the year. This heterogeneity demands diversified approaches and strategies for their education on the part of the government. Therefore, special interventions are needed for attracting and retaining the tribal children in school. The innovative programs initiated for them are enrollment and retention drives. The special retention drives are initiated for them, special camps and bridge courses, setting up of special models of alternative schools have initiated for them, providing a congenial learning environment inside and outside the school is very important here. At the beginning of primary education, textbooks in mother tongue must be provided for these children as they do not understand regional language. Special training should be provided to non-tribal teachers to work in tribal areas. It includes the knowledge of tribal dialect. The non-tribal teachers must be feel comfortable in teaching these children. Then, more Anganwadis and Balwadis or creches in each school of tribal areas should be established, so that the girls are not required to do babysitting. Free textbooks to all children up to class 8 must be adhered. Free hostel facilities with books, with food, with notebooks, uniform, etc. must be taken care of. Community resources that can be mobilized for monitoring attendance and providing remedial classes. An effort should be made to enhance child-child interaction. The learners must be suggested to undertake group activities. At the last, the relaxation with respect to evaluation and examination must be taken care of. The disparity between the education of the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe and other weaker sections of society is very wide. This disparity can be removed only through giving special attention to these neglected sections of the society. Research-based interventions are required in a number of areas that have an impact on the classroom, that have an impact on the classroom experiences of these children. Research is needed, for example, to explore the circumstances for students who have entered the education system in grade 1. In order to understand how they can be motivated to stay in school, in order to make them progress from one grade to the next. To some extent, parents may be highly motivated to encourage their children to stay in school, but may be constrained by their poverty or discouraged by the child's schooling experiences or by the lack of achievement by the learner in a school. So, teacher education programs, in-service training and teacher recruitment policies need to be at the center of our research and policy agenda. Similarly, textbooks and primers used in primary education need to provide positive representation of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe cultures and histories. The government policies focused on education of scheduled tribes are the main avenue by which we can integrate them into a mainstream society. Now, let's discuss the quality improvement program for ashram schools. The concept of ashram schools or residential schools for scheduled tribe children were established to overcome structural barriers and thereby improve the educational access for scheduled tribe communities. A centrally sponsored government scheme of ashram schools, especially for scheduled tribe children, it was initiated in 1970 and it continues to the present. Ashram schools include vocational training in their curricula in order to provide skills and training that is required for jobs in the industrial sector. Considering the poor quality of teaching and infrastructure and the distance of these schools from the communities, it is hardly surprising that many families prefer not to send their children to ashram schools, and the dropout rate is high among those who do. Over the last two decades, the government has increased elementary school provision, that is from grade 1st to 8th in and near tribal hamlets, and this has seen a significantly increased rate of enrollment. However, issues of quality and relevance of schooling for scheduled tribe children have barely received any attention from the national government. Poor treatment in schools results in dropouts or poor performance in examinations, thus undermining the opportunities to progress in higher levels of education. Now, let's sum up. Today we have discussed the nature of exclusion and discrimination faced by scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, the socio-economic conditions. We discussed the national policies and programs which aim to improve school access and equity, and the special efforts made by state governments to improve educational participation of these communities. Thank you.